CBS News.
Where dreams are sullied, hearts are broken, and vices are embraced. A harsh place, located somewhere deep in the broken human spirit. A landscape so harsh that it is barren of both compassion and cruelty. Imagine a sign hanging over the entrance. Work doesn't mean freedom. Work means more work and disappointment. Imagine the gates closing behind you as you listlessly march in. And imagine me as your tour guide. Well, for the next 3 hours, I will be your spirit guide through a world untouched by God's love. The world of law and disorder.
The record scratch, man. Oh, f***. Oops, are we live? This must be Law and Disorder, then.
Welcome to Law and Disorder. I'm your host, Ken Goldberg. Must be 4 o'clock. I'm going to be here till 6 o'clock. Not till 7, even though I said 3 hours. Those of you that know me know that that's an old tape. Those of you that don't know me, hey, you're about to get introduced to the most enlightening and edifying 2 hours of radio time broadcast in a week, anywhere, anytime, anyhow. And, look, I'm very low energy today, so don't screw with me. I'm not in a good mood. So when you call in, 529-3508, to join in the conversation, bring some intellectual prowess with you. I don't care if you want to challenge my ideas about the world. I have some screwy ideas about how it all works. But don't come at me with anything that reeks of intellectual bankruptcy, because quite frankly, I don't entertain that type of attitude. Now, let me tell you what's going on. This show, Law and Disorder, new here on the to this station, was broadcast for years in Dallas, Texas, and now I'm here and I'm broadcasting. I'm having a good time. You can find out more about the show by going to www.law-disorder.com. You can read a little bit about the history of me, the history of the show. You can also hear some old shows on the website by hitting certain links. I'm not quite sure what's loaded and what isn't loaded. You can also email me anytime, 24 hours a day. It's a beautiful thing. At ken@law-disorder.com. Now, typically, we do a lot of funky news here. Things about guns, drugs, rock and roll, anything I really want to cover that I don't think is covered very well in the mainstream. I have some great articles I want to talk about this week. But on my way here, some things happened to me emotionally, mentally, psychologically, and spiritually. For one, I saw a bumper sticker that just rocked my boat. It said, "Who would Jesus kill?" That's a great bumper sticker. I got to thinking about that. You know, because the Christian right is in control of the American government and seems to have a very clear and articulate idea of who we got to kill. And me, silly me, I'm a lawyer. I'm 53 years old. I've been to a significant part of the world. A lot of people call me educated. A lot of people call me very bright. And yet I have no clue who needs to be killed other than those persons which are immediately threatening my safety and welfare. But this government has got a real hang on what I call a preemptive strike. In fact, Scott McClellan, he's Bush's spokesperson. He's the press aide. He was on doing a press conference this week, and he couldn't have been more emphatic about the United States government's right to operate preemptively everywhere and anywhere at any time, anyhow, because war operates by different rules than a polite society. Meantime, while he was being challenged by the media, he kept resorting to this preemptive, this notion. It's, he said, a time-honored, a long history of. If you look around, this whole notion of preemptive, other than looking at, you could look at, what's his name, the Greek guy. Just did a movie about him. What was his name?
Alexander?
Alexander. You can look at Napoleon Bonaparte. You can look at a lot of guys who really were good at this whole preemptive thing.
Yeah, I think there was one called Adolf that did it to Poland and a few other ones.
Absolutely. You know, so this whole idea of that there's a long and rich history of a government being able to act preemptively, you know.
In fascist governments, yes.
If we chose our targets well, we wouldn't be having this conversation. The reason we're having this conversation is our government sucks at the whole implementation of a preemptive strike, a preemptive militaristic approach to any of the targets they've chosen lately. Iraq was never, never, never a legitimate or rational target by any legitimate or rational purvey of the facts that prevailed at the time that we took our actions. There was no pressing need to act preemptively against Iraq. For those 15 of you out there who are still clinging to the notion that your government acted responsibly, I can only say you have done a great job of closing your ears, your eyes, and every other sense to the facts. There's not a reasonable, rational argument swirling around in the public domain that would give credibility or legitimacy to our presence in Iraq. There may be a legitimate reason to be in Iraq. We just don't know what it is. How much does our government have a right to protect us from the truth? Because if they're not protecting us from the truth, if they've put their truth out there, then we're in trouble. Anyways, I'm troubled by that. You can join and argue with me anytime if you think you have intellectually rich argument to share with the listeners of the station by calling 529-358. Chuck, you look like you're trying to say something.
Well, no, I'm just thinking, you know, I'm really liking where you're going, and I'd just like to interject that, you know, the same people that tried selling us, or really sold us, this bill of goods on Iraq are now trying to sell us the same bill of goods about Iran. Are you buying?
Well, a lot of people predicted this 5 years ago when we began to encroach on Iraq. It's been argued from the beginning by a number of very bright people, although I'm not sure I'm buying it even today, that first we went into Afghanistan and then, whoa, what? Well, all of a sudden we were in Iraq. If you look who's in the middle, Iran was in the middle of Iraq and Afghanistan. But you don't attack Iran like you do Iraq. For those of you that think that Iran is a Middle Eastern pushover, you don't know the history of Iran. Iran is not, quote-unquote, a Middle Eastern nation. It is not an Arab nation. It is a Persian nation. It doesn't have the history of losing militarily as the Arabs do. It doesn't have the history of its air force and its ground troops going around in circles chasing its tail. These guys have a rich and lengthy, rewarding history as warriors. So screwing with Iran is a much greater undertaking.
Well, yeah, it's a country three times the size, twice the population of Iran, and much better armed.
Much better.
I mean,
much better trained.
Shahab-1 missiles, if we made the mistake of bombing or letting Israel go bomb their supposed nuclear facilities, Shahab missiles would probably sink most of what we have in the Persian Gulf within the first half hour.
Well, I don't know enough about that because I'm under the impression that we've got enough defensive equipment in there to do significant damage, but you could disable Iran in the air through missiles. You still ain't conquered Iran. You still ain't set foot inside the country. You think you got a guerrilla warfare going on in Iraq?
Yeah.
So anyways, we don't have the military to challenge Iran now.
Well, we don't even have the military to handle things in Iraq. How are we going to handle things in Iran?
Now, I want to segue somewhere that's got almost nothing to do with this.
Shifting gears here.
Okay. Shifting gears, but equally troubling. On my way here, I wanted to share with you something I discovered, and I brought somebody with me to the studio today, and we may introduce him later on in the show. His name is Gary. Now, Gary understands the concept of vaporizing, okay? Now, vaporizing is something I have, look, I go to adult entertainment boutiques.
Venues.
I go to, I call them head shops, but you can't call them head shops if you're a head shop. Smoke shops, okay? The hippie gypsy and things like that. Anyways, I was thinking, you know, I've been meaning to talk about this concept of vaporizing because it's really interesting. While I'm not an advocate of any kind of smoking, including up to and including drug use, marijuana, whatever, I don't advocate it. I'm aware of it. I've been aware of it since the age of 14. And I had the opportunity to be have explained to me this concept of vaporizing, which absolutely blew my mind. I had it explained to me three times now. And each time it just curls my toes because the idea seems to be that you can take, and for the moment I'll stay on this side of the line, okay? You can take herbs. You can put them in a bowl. You can heat them up to a certain temperature. And you can smoke the herbs without creating ash. So what it is somehow it's a process of sucking the moisture and the elements that induce altered attitude from a product without actually burning the product and getting things like the nicotine, would it be nicotine or would it be tar? I think it would be tar. Nicotine wouldn't be found. It'd be tar. Anyways, the byproducts of smoking, which are generally considered hazardous by all. Okay. So, but when I had explained to me, my friend Gary was present and he nodded. He's like, yeah, that makes sense to me. And I'm like, I called him over. I said, you're lying to me, to this kid who was explaining vaporizing me. I'm like, you know, it's like...
He's right, actually.
I know. Well, I know a lot more about it since the first time I was told about it. By the way, I've just taped William Shatner's How I Changed the Universe or something to that effect. You know about that?
I haven't run into that particular one, my friend.
It's running on A&E or something. And what it is, it's a quasi-documentary with William Shatner, and essentially it's how Star Trek changed the future, which is now today. And it's kind of interesting. Anyways, so this vaporizing thing. Now, while I started thinking about vaporizing and I started thinking about talking about it on the show, I encountered another problem. I started thinking about, well, when I was explained vaporizing, I was in a public shop. A private shop, public forum, and a smoke shop. Okay, it's a smoke shop. And they could not use language. Certain language is banned. Are you aware of what I'm talking about, Chuck?
Yes.
Okay. For instance, if you went into a smoke shop and you saw a water pipe and you said, and I actually had this experience. This is almost verbatim what happened to me one time. I was about to interview the head of Texas Normal back when I was in Texas. And I hadn't had any real experience with drugs in, I guess, 18 years. So I wanted to be prepared for the show. I tried to always do my homework. I went out and bought a copy of High Times. I read that. And then I went to a head shop, what I call a head shop. So I go in, and I want, I'm asking questions. And the guy is being very guarded in his use of language. And I'm going along with him up to a point. At some point, I said, do you sell any bongs? Because when I was a kid, or let's say when I got clean in 1982, bongs did not exist. Their water pipes did, but bongs didn't.
They hadn't come up with the name.
They hadn't come up with the name, exactly. So I said bong, truly not knowing what a bong is. He says to me, we don't sell bongs, but we have water pipes. Now, by the way, he was being very gracious because I know now a lot of stores will throw you out the first word like bong, weed, anything like
joint,
that.
Joint, yeah, anything.
Yes. So I went over and I looked at the water pipes and I went back to him and I said, so how do those differ from a bong? And he said, well, a bong is illegal and a water pipe isn't. And I got mad because I'm thinking, playing me for a fool. I'm thinking this guy is treating me just like an idiot. I'm not aware of the consequences of the law at the time. And I'm thinking there's First Amendment rights here. And this guy and I should be able to have a conversation based upon the First Amendment. We've got the right of speech. But see, what I didn't understand was they're not curtailing my right to speech by attacking the First Amendment. What they're doing is they're criminalizing our items. And then if you admit that those items exist, now you're culpable under criminal law.
Quite a catch-22, isn't it?
Right. So if he at any point admits that the rolling machine could be used to make a joint, or that the bong, the water pipe could be a bong, or any of these little acknowledgments,
yeah,
then he's acknowledging possession of paraphernalia, and he can go to jail. And I'm like, well, that's crazy. Well, it doesn't stop there. Go to an adult emporium,
boutique.
Yes. Try, for instance, to get an artificial penis. You can't do it. They don't sell them.
Okay. They sell novelty items.
They sell novelty items. They sell cake toppers and marital aids. But none of those marital aids qualifies as a dildo under the law. Unless you use the word dildo to identify them. Then you've broken the law. Because now you've acknowledged possession of apparently, I don't know, an obscene item or something. You can join in the conversation, 529-3508. There was a woman in Texas who was arrested two times for selling a dildo. Here's what happened. She apparently worked someplace where they sold kick toppers. On two separate occasions, for somehow, this woman managed to get herself busted. And she, her second case, she gets jailed for 30 days under Texas law. That conviction was challenged and it went up to an appellate court of Texas. And the appellate court of Texas said, they upheld the conviction, said that this was absolutely a correct interpretation of law. But there was a concurring opinion, which while concurring was amusing, which I wouldn't say that the general opinion about this law was amusing, but a female judge on the appellate court said, while I uphold today's ruling, because the law is constitutional, she said, the only thing we've achieved is to make the cost of a dildo in Texas more expensive. Okay. Understand what she said. She said point blank, a cake topper can be a dildo. A dildo, in her estimation, had no inherent detriment. Thus, the only purpose of the law is to drive up the cost of these items because of the necessary safeguards that people have to take. So I came into the studio today and I said to Chuck, I said, how openly can we talk versus the people in the shops? Now, by the way, when I read this Texas appellate case on the air, the kid who was my board operator in Texas at the time freaked out and actually hit the delay button when I used the word dildo. And I said to him, I said, what did you just do? He said, I don't think you can say that. I said, I'm reading a legal case. This is taken from the legal annals. Texas legal annals.
Wait. You can say dildo. You just can't say annals.
Now, by the way, since then, the FCC is much more harsh. But it still wouldn't affect us because we're not doing things simply to titillate here. We're doing them for the legitimate purpose of having an intellectual discourse. We are engaging in the lively art of conversation. I'm going to wind down a little bit. I've thrown two very broad-ranging subjects out onto the table. You can give feedback to me on the air by dialing 529-3508, but we're coming up on the news, which we have at the half hour and the top of the hour. About 2 minutes, I would guess, we're going to go to news. So I want to begin to wind down. My voice is getting weak. I want to go... Can you pick out some musical thing that we can do so I can recover my voice and people can recover their thoughts? What do we have today that we might entertain the folks with?
I don't know. How about a little something from a guy who's been in the news himself lately, Mr. Isaac Hayes, a.k.a. Chef.
Oh, yeah, what do you got? Oh, yeah, let's...
Theme from Chef, from Chef.
Well, you're going to keep an eye on that one.
Oh, yeah, man.
All right. We're going to be right back. Call your friends. Tell them, turn on 1330. That crazy show, Law and Disorder.
CNN Radio, I'm Matt Cherry. New York, D.C., Boston, L.A., some of the cities where anti-war protests took place Saturday, marking 3 years since the U.S.-led invasion of Iraq began. President Bush presented a more optimistic front on the conflict in his weekly radio address.
America and the world are safer today, without Saddam Hussein in power.
Demonstrations also in France, these ones over a controversial new labor law. Newsweek reporter Eric Papa says witnesses in Paris say extremists are turning the peaceful protests into full-fledged riots.
I think you have a few hundred or maybe a few thousand in all over France who were looking for confrontations with police, who in Paris lit a couple of cars on fire and basically threw whatever they could at the police.
Two U.S. naval ships returned fire after being attacked by suspected pirates off of Somalia. One suspect is killed, five are hurt. The Dallas Cowboys signed controversial wide receiver Terrell Owens. This is CNN Radio. Three spots in the NCAA tournament's Sweet 16 are set. Florida advances with an 82-60 victory over Wisconsin-Milwaukee. Gators coach Billy Donovan says his team just has great chemistry right now.
This team, personality-wise, complements each other pretty well. You know, Joe Kim is a very, very emotional kid. He's always upbeat. He never has a bad day. He's always jumping around, bouncing around. You know, Al Horford's kind of very stoic, serious, doesn't really show a lot of emotion.
Wichita State upsets second-seeded Tennessee. Overall, number one seed Duke is victorious over George Washington. Gunfire at a college frat party in Carolina. Police say a man who was kicked out of the party early Saturday later returned with a gun. Witnesses say he fired into the crowd, injuring five people. There's new interest in a game all about the Patriot Act. This Monopoly send-off pokes fun at the anti-terrorism law. For example, instead of going to jail, you go to Guantanamo Bay. This is CNN Radio.
With so many brands to save on at the PetSmart Big Brands event, it's hard to remember them, unless you make up a song.
Eukanuba, Beneful, Alpo, Iams, Pro Plan, One Science Diet, Natural Choice, and then there is Pedigree.
Even if you don't make up a song, save up to 15% on hundreds of items from PetSmart's best-selling brands, like 20-pound bags of Iams dog food, now just $13.99 with your Pet Perk Savings Card. Our biggest brands at the best prices. That's smart. PetSmart. While supplies last, see store for details.
I love to take outdoor pictures, but when my allergies get really bad, my itchy, watery eyes keep me from doing what I love to do. I feel like I'm in a fog. Now I'm Claritin Clear, which means I'm staying in control of my allergies and staying alert. Claritin gives me non-drowsy relief from my worst sneezing, runny nose, and itchy eyes for 24 hours. And only Claritin is proven to make me as alert and focused as someone without allergies. So I can think more clearly and I won't miss a thing. 24-hour non-drowsy Claritin. Live Claritin Clear.
Use as directed. Only brand clinically tested.
Well,
oh yeah, Poe Lazarus from, actually I know what it's from, but I thought it was good. Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, that's what it's from. It's from Oh Brother, Where Art Thou, but by James Carter and the Prisoners. The reason I liked it and thought it was appropriate is because the subjects I'm talking about really revolve around the new age in America. We're going to be criminalized in the future for one reason or another. We are already the most criminalized nation in the Western civilized world, significantly. How is it that we are so full of criminal doers? How come our nation, year after year, can lead all other Western civilized nations? Is it the absence of Christianity? Can't be that. It's Christianity everywhere you look. Can it be a lack of God? Hell, it's on our money. So what? What is making us such a criminal, such a large criminal element? Well, here's my hypothesis, okay? We're no more criminal than the other nation. We just get arrested. with greater frequency and with greater zealousness than they do anywhere else in the Western civilized world. See, the rest of the Western civilized world has decided to some extent to what we call, lamely in academia, prioritize. But the United States government and all these small jurisdictions like the state of Arizona, the city of Tucson, man, when it comes to priorities, they're just about racking up some numbers. There's always a demon out there. There's always something that's going to make us less than a good society. Right now, it's methamphetamine. You sneeze, and you're going to be picked up for having put some methamphetamine up your nose. I mean, that's, look, bus north of downtown bags 18. Let me read this from the Arizona Daily Star. Crack dealers near treatment facilities had folks trapped in their own homes. More than a dozen crack cocaine dealers were arrested Wednesday. Now, here's something interesting. I said meth, and they're saying crack cocaine. I didn't even know anybody was still doing crack cocaine. This blew my mind. Anyways, it says here about 6 weeks ago, the Counter-Narcotics Alliance. I always love when they come up with these names because back home in Illinois, it was Metropolitan Enforcement Group. And in Texas, they had some other name for it. You can't go anywhere in the nation today and not have a cool-sounding drug enforcement group. This one is the Counter-Narcotics Alliance. Was contacted by Cope Behavioral Services about crack dealers near a Cope facility on Drachman Street near North Stone Avenue. Now, I don't know where Drachman Street is. I know where Stone is. And I've been given a kind of a, it's been a little bit north of Speedway. Is that correct, Chuck?
Drachman is actually between Stone and Glen, I believe. Grant and Glen? Glen. Perhaps Drachman is down.
Okay.
I'm drawing a blank too. Too much meth today.
Anyways, doesn't matter. It says because Cope assists vulnerable adults by providing safe and subsidized living facility, officials were concerned about the residents' welfare. I have no problem with that. You should always be concerned about those that you are responsible for the care of. It says this is supposed to be a safe and secure environment, and these dealers were taking advantage of that. Now, that doesn't make any sense to me. What does that mean? That the facility, they were dealing out of the facility? That makes no sense. Were they dealing out of the parking lot? That makes no sense. So what is the creation of a safe environment got to do with some drug dealers standing on the corner? But let's keep going on. The activity level was so high that officers often did not have to approach dealers. The dealers would come to them. On Wednesday, officers returned to the area to round up 32 people who were identified for drug-related charges. But in all, only 18 were arrested. Okay, one more time. They went to get 32. They only came back with 18. That means that another 14 are missing. By the way, there's no. The officers claim to have purchased about 12 ounces of crack. Now, that's a lot of purchasing, and I assume that's going to go a long way in court, although you don't have to wait to buy 12 ounces of cocaine to get these guys off the streets. You can buy a small bag from them and then bag them. One guy that they arrested, he didn't make it to the police station. He boogied while being processed at the scene. That man is supposedly Ricardo Ruiz, 33 years of age, and has been identified as a high-volume dealer. Okay. Now, I don't mean to shrug or laugh at law enforcement. Well, yes, I do. Here's another case that simply tells me that we're trying to criminalize a segment of the population desperately. To what end? Okay, here again, from the same local media. Case against Hell's Angel leader tossed. Federal charges that were brought against the president of the local chapter of the Hell's Angel, talking about Tucson, in a high-profile racketeering case that targeted motorcycle gangs across Arizona, have been dismissed. The case was the result of a sting touted as the most successful infiltration ever of the biker group. That sting resulted in half of the people arrested being given plea deals on lesser offenses. Okay. The most time anybody in this big sting operation got is going to be like 5 years. Charges against five others, including the president and a friend of his, Craig Kelly and Henry Watkins, according to the media, were dismissed. Dismissed means nothing. They got zip, zero, zilch. The federal government arrested, prepared a prosecution, but could not carry out the prosecution. They couldn't even take it to trial and lose. They had to dismiss the charges. That means that they didn't have a significant foundation upon which to pursue the case. One of the, who in the God's name is this guy? Oh, okay. I guess this is one of the court-appointed attorneys says they have some information they just do not want to give out. We think it's because they had a disagreement about some of their ATF agents. Well, here's what they're really the problem is. They use what we call CIs, confidential informants. These are not undercover officers. These are undercover people. These are people who, for one reason or another, have decided to cooperate with the government in prosecuting others. So by that, I mean they may have committed crimes themselves and got their little wee-wees in a nut grinder, or through some other means, a close relative of theirs is in deep trouble. It says here, with help from moles, ATF agents spent 2 years, ATF is alcohol, tobacco, and firearm, spent 2 years penetrating the Hells Angels, attending drug parties, and becoming privy to alleged murder plots against rival gangs. Investigators describe the club as a criminal syndicate, not a fraternity of motorcycle enthusiasts. And I don't doubt that. But that still doesn't make a case. Guns, drugs, and thousands of records were seized. By the way, no mention whether any of the guns were illegal. The drugs were probably illegal. And thousands of records. What kind of records do the Hells Angels keep? What birth records? Monitoring transactions? I sort of doubt it. I can't imagine what these thousands of records. Now, an attorney for a guy in Mesa said that details of misconduct by ATF informers have been described in court as one paid operative failed to tell his handlers that he had participated in a murder, and another became a snitch to avoid prosecution, eventually then got busted again with methamphetamine. Okay, so you got maybe a half a dozen Hells Angels, the other half dismissed. But here's what it took to accomplish this. More than 170 local and federal officers were involved in a series of pre-dawn raids that led to the arrest. Officials conducted synchronized raids in the Phoenix area where one suspect was shot and wounded by an officer, as well as in Flagstaff, Prescott, Bullhead City, and Kingman. In all, 30 people arrested and seized drugs and weapons from 40 locations. 30 people took 170 local and federal officers. Man, back in Chicago, they used to get 30. Two officers used to come over to our house, Gary, didn't they? And they could get 15. With no effort at all. No effort at all. My God. I went over to Gary's house. They were marching 15 out of his house. Give him a microphone. Is there a microphone in there that's hot?
I can make it hot. You just got to click it on.
Speak, Gary. No, it's not that one.
Try it.
Now, go ahead. Talk into it again.
Click the other. Click either one or two on the board in there, and that'll.
We're working out some technical difficulties. Keep talking. I think I hear you. Go ahead.
Yes, they could get
there. You go.
Many people from my house. Many people used to come by. Many people had a good time.
The time that they marched you and all your friends out, how many were there total in the house?
I think about 12 people that time, really.
12 people. How many officers did it take?
Two.
Two officers, 12, folks, 12 suspects taken into custody. And it took 170.
But we were a nonviolent group.
That's true. That's true. All right. You got me there. As long as I've got you here, quickly tell me, vaporizing, how does it work?
Well, you heat the herbs to a point that you'll release the vapors without hitting an ignition point.
By the way, the herb that is most favored by the people I know, you heat to 360 degrees. Go ahead.
Anyway, this just releases the vapors and the, we'll just say, the goodies, the part that in the herbs that is going to...
If it were tobacco, let's use tobacco as a functional herb.
Okay.
What would be the benefit of putting tobacco in a vaporizer as opposed to smoking it in a pipe or in a cigarette?
You're basically not going to get the amount of tar, nicotine, all of things from combustion. You're only going to heat it to a point that you'll release the vapor, and you'll leave 99% of the bad things behind.
Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? And how again? Now, when you say vapor, why is vapor helpful? I mean, what is vapor?
It's the moisture, the liquid content in any dry substance you look at. There's a certain amount of moisture in it. You heat it to this point, and it releases that. And
without creating any ash, right?
Without creating any ash whatsoever. You still have the same amount of product when you're done, which you can then recycle. We should all recycle anything and everything that we can. And the economics of it say this is a good thing.
Okay, thank you. We'll get back to you.
Thank you.
Right now we're going to get to Charles. Charles, you're on the air.
Ken, how you doing?
This is Charles calling from a local prison.
Yeah, the local federal prison.
Ah.
Remember, I'm not the state joint down the street.
No, I know you're from federal, but I know you're local, though.
Hey, you know, vaporizers, that's commonly used by medical marijuana patients, too.
Well, it wasn't when I was interviewing medical marijuana patients, but I'm not surprised to hear that.
They have a machine that it's like fills up like a bag. And then they simply inhale the bag.
I saw one of those for sale, and I want to say those things aren't cheap.
No, well, you know, it's medical marijuana. Hey, two things I wanted to weigh in with you on. First of all, I couldn't believe it this week. All the hysterics over the Massawi sentencing with Leona Brinkema, the Judge Brinkema, and the Miller, the prosecuting attorney, and her leaking.
Carla Martin.
What did you want to say about it?
Well, they made such a big deal out of the government coaching the witnesses and how it's such a, you know, that it's a no-no. And she said, well, she didn't know. And everybody said, come on, it's rule one. The problem is that, you see, they're dealing with witnesses they don't have under their thumb. These are just FAA people that are going to come in and testify. But, you know, the whole idea that the government doesn't coach witnesses is so ludicrous to me is to be just beyond imagination. I mean, they coach when they have witnesses. Think what they do. This is them coaching FAA people. They just want them to testify. Think of what they do with people where how much time they're going to serve in prison depends on how much they cooperate.
Now, let me say something. As a lawyer, by the way, I know that there are certain limitations on information you're supposed to give a witness. I've never heard of the limitations that have been invoked in this case, but that's because they were invoked through a court order, not through the normal channel of procedural understandings. In other words, you can typically give information to a witness about what is going on in trial. They can't sit there. There's something called the rule.
Right. They can't sit in the courtroom.
They can't sit in the courtroom, but it doesn't mean you can't give them an idea of what the testimony has been. And I'll ask a witness, I'll say, look, I had a witness, the government has a witness said this. Can you refute that? Because if you can't refute that, I don't know that I need you anymore. Now that I've heard what the government has to say, you know, I only knew up to a point what my witnesses had to say. You rarely know what the government witnesses are going to say until they've actually testified. Now that I've heard them testify, I may say, can you refute that? Can you supplement that? Can you complement? Can you do anything with that? If not, I may not bother calling you. It's a different thing to provide a transcript of testimony or opening statements. I've never felt free to share a transcript, a verbatim transcript, with anybody in the trial other than co-counsel.
But you're one of those nasty, devious defense attorneys. You're not one of those honest, upstanding prosecutors.
Well, prosecutors are fairly reluctant to step outside of the bounds because
don't go there. They've been outside the box so long they wouldn't know how to get themselves back in it if you gave them a map.
Well,
I totally disagree with you there. Well, and my other point, though, I wanted to bring up.
Done cases where it's obvious to me they didn't do a. If they coached, they certainly didn't do a very good job because I won the case. I won it handily, and the people.
That's a little injured. So you from the warden. Anyway, the other one is too. Is did you see that thing on that big international child pornography internet case?
Yes.
This week, and they're screaming and they're about how horrible. And these are people that you could actually get on this thing and get child sex acts to order because I guess they would stage them.
Yeah, one of them was a lieutenant at the California Highway Patrol.
And one of them was somebody up in Mesa, Arizona, too. And they're just screaming about how heinous this is, and I've never seen a worse crime and stuff. You know what those people will get for sentences, don't you? Mandatory minimum 5-year sentences. That's about all that any of them will get, even if they get that much, you know. And to sit here and think, you know, people are screaming about how heinous this crime is. Well, if it's such a heinous crime, why isn't the penalty for it harsher? Why don't those people get mandatory life sentences, or at least mandatory minimum 20-year sentences? Why do they?
What's your theory on that?
My theory is most judges are child molesters, actually, at this point in my life, to tell you the truth, but that's probably a little out there. But I don't know. I honestly don't know.
I mean, I'm not in favor of any more mandatory minimums. Sounds like you're saying, you know, I've been victimized by it. Why aren't more people victimized by mandatory minimums?
What I'm saying is if anything does deserve a mandatory minimum sentence, but in those cases, they look at child molesters as being sick, not criminal. And so, I mean, what about that case a while ago where the judge gave the guy 60 days in prison for a child molester?
You know, I won't discuss a case that I don't have the facts on. I know all about that case as much as the media permitted me to know, and I don't think we know 1/5 of what went on in that case. I think that was taken out of context, and I refuse to discuss that case.
This call is from a federal prison.
Because I simply don't have enough information on that case.
Let me ask you something. As an attorney, and I found this interesting, too. You had all this uproar over that case where they gave the guy, like, 60 days. So the judge went back and resentenced him and upped his sentence to 24 months. What right to once your sentence does?
Yeah, I know. That was an interesting, turn of events that the judge felt free to resentence somebody on his own.
On what ground? I could see if the government appealed it, it was.
Well, it's possible the government did file a motion.
But no, on a motion, but I'm talking about a remand to the appellate court. If it went up to the appellate court and the appellate court said.
It didn't go up to the appellate court.
What?
It didn't go up to the
That's
appellate
court. That's what I mean. How do you get, like, so.
Well, the government had the right. And we don't know that they didn't do it. That's why I don't talk about something I don't know anything about. What I'm saying to you is, it's very probable that the prosecutor filed the motion for a new sentencing.
Oh, and how do you sentence him once he's already sentenced?
Well, same way that when my client is sentenced, I can file a motion for the reduction of the sentence.
Right, but that has to go through a process. You don't just.
No, it doesn't go through a process. It goes right back to the same judge that did the sentencing.
Well,
you're wrong.
Not in federal court. Once you're sentenced.
In federal court, if I do things in a timely manner, I can ask a judge to revisit his sentencing. If I do it in a timely manner, and this wasn't a federal case, number one. Number two, any state court that I've ever appeared in, I could go back within 30 days and I could say, reduce the sentence, and I would file a motion saying, here are the grounds upon which I believe you should reduce the sentence.
And then, too, that's a reduction of sentence. But here you have
the other side who says that there was a miscalculation of some sort, and they argued on some facts they presented to the judge saying that he was wrong, that he either was outside the law in his sentencing and had to comport with the law. Look, a judge can say, I'm giving you probation, and walk off the court, and you're not leaving jail because the law may say probation is not available in that case. Okay?
Yeah, that's true.
So we don't, and I'm going to keep saying over and over, we don't have the facts. You didn't get the facts in that case. You got the frenzy reported
about that case. But then follow on this case now with this internet. I mean, you're talking an international network of child pornographers, right? And all these people describe it as the most heinous thing they've ever seen in their lives. But yet, watch when these guys get sentenced. They won't get particularly heinous sentences. They'll get, I mean, a 5-year sentence in the federal
government. Of course, nowadays they can be kept behind bars afterwards for an indefinite period of time, as you well know.
Yeah, they can.
They can be kept through a civil proceeding and never be released.
They can
go directly from prison to a psychiatric facility, a locked psychiatric facility, for an umpteen number of years.
Right, that's public law. They can be public law. Right.
So,
but some of these things, and once again, in the Brinkema case and with Massawi, I mean, here you have one of the most prominent sentencing cases happening in the federal courts across the nation, and you have this woman, prosecutor, feeding the transcript.
No, she wasn't a prosecutor. Carla Martin's not a prosecutor. She's an attorney. She's a mid-level attorney for the FAA.
Okay, but she and feeding this information to her. Do you think the judge is going to try to get her for contempt of court?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think so.
And
yeah, this is a big embarrassment for everybody. That lady's in trouble.
But you know,
she's already been put on administrative leave.
Well,
everybody's trying to distance themselves from that lady, dude.
Well, I know, but how about if they give her contempt of court, what do you think they'll do to her?
Well, she wasn't a party to the case, so to speak, so there's very little they can do to her. I'm not even sure how much a contempt citation can go with this, because she was not a party to the case. I'm not sure she fell under the jurisdiction of the court.
It's still, I mean, everybody around here, we were all, let me tell you a real quick story, and then I'll finish up. At my trial, we had a guy that was going to testify against me and another guy. We'd never heard of this guy before, never seen him before, didn't know any idea who he was. So when they call the witness and they go out to get him, me and the other guy who are sitting with three other defendants, we stand up and swap places and sit back down, right? When the guy comes back in and he goes to identify us, he cross-identifies us. He identifies me as the other guy is me, and people are chuckling. But they don't realize. I mean, he was coached. He had no idea who he was. They just told him, okay, the one guy's sitting on the aisle, the other guy's sitting to his, you know, two guys to his left, right? So the whole thing that coaching doesn't happen is absurd. I mean, it happens every day in federal court.
All right, man.
All right. Got to go. That's the beep.
Ciao, babe. All right, we're coming up on the news hour. You can join in, 529-3508, anytime yourself. You can criticize, compliment, supplement, whatever you want to do with this radio show. It's your radio show. I own it, but it's yours. I give it to you. You, the people, may share in this. Luxuriate in it, man, because you ain't going to get a chance to talk to some people as bright as Chuck, myself, Gary, and the rest of the crew here. I mean, we're just a bunch of bright mother. Hush your mouth. By the way, we're going up to CBS News now, and I want to say this. I'm offended by today's news broadcast. I was offended by the fact that Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt got any amount of time on the broadcast, much less that they actually took up more time in the last hour with Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt kissing passionately in Italy than they gave to the fact that a bunch of grade school kids were expelled from school for having a toy gun at the school.
Yeah, one tried to sell a toy gun.
One did sell, and he was expelled. Another one bought it. Another one touched it.
Yeah, two of them saw it, and they were even kicked out for 3 days.
They touched it. They didn't just see it. They touched it.
Oh, heaven forfend. Oh,
so come on back with us. We'll be right back after the news broadcast. We got more to talk about. We got another hour to go on Law and Disorder.
Constant sorrow through his day. I am the man of constant sorrow. I've seen trouble all my day.
Hot news, hot talk to the great Southwest. This is the Jolt. AM 1330, KJLL, South Tucson.